Welcome to the Journal. There was good news and bad news about Afghanistan this week, and it was the same news. That's right. The Senate held confirmation hearings for Lieutenant General Stanley McChrystal, slated to be the next commander of U.S. forces in Afghanistan. Here's how two different news organizations reported his testimony. The Associated Press headline read, "War in Afghanistan is winnable." But the Washington Independent reported that the general had, quote, painted a bleak picture of the Afghanistan war and that the United States needed to show significant progress within 18 to 24 months or risk the war spiraling out of control. What we know for sure is that the fighting in Afghanistan is escalating. At least 21,000 more American troops are going in, and the number of private security contractors working for the military there jumped 29% in the last 3 months alone. Get this, there are now more private contractors in Afghanistan than there are U.S. soldiers. And as of next year, according to new Pentagon documents, the war in Afghanistan will be costing more than the war in Iraq. It's the job of experienced, knowledgeable investigative reporters to throw a monkey wrench into the spin machine and try to make some sense of all this. They're an endangered species, but one of the best in the business is Jeremy Scahill, who's been digging into Pentagon documents and thick congressional hearings for several years now. He's twice winner of the George Polk Award for Special Achievement in Journalism and author of this best-selling book, Blackwater, The Rise of the World's Most Powerful Mercenary Army. Jeremy now runs the new website, Rebel Reports. Jeremy Scahill, welcome back to the Journal.
It's great to be with you, Bill.
How do you explain this spike in private contractors in both Iraq and Afghanistan?
Well, I think what we're seeing under President Barack Obama is sort of old wine in a new bottle. Obama is sending one message to the world, but the reality on the ground, particularly when it comes to private military contractors, is that the status quo remains from the Bush era. Right now, there are 250,000 contractors fighting the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. That's about 50% of the total U.S. fighting force, which is very similar to what it was under Bush. In Iraq, President Obama has 130,000 contractors, and we just saw a 23% increase in the number of armed contractors in Iraq. In Afghanistan, there's been a 29% increase in armed contractors. So the radical privatization of war continues unabated under Barack Obama. Having said that, when Barack Obama was in the Senate, he was one of the only people that was willing to take up this issue. And he put forward what became the leading legislation on the part of the Democrats to reform the contracting industry. And I give him credit for doing that because he saw this as an important issue before a lot of other political figures and spoke up at a time when a lot of people were deafeningly silent on this issue. And President Obama has carried on a policy where he has tried to implement greater accountability structures. We now know in a much clearer way than we did under Bush how many contractors we have on the battlefield. He's attempted to implement some form of rules governing contractors and has suggested that there should be greater accountability when they do commit crimes. All of these things are a step in the right direction. But ultimately, I think that we have to look to what Jan Schakowsky, the congresswoman from Illinois, says. We can no longer allow these individuals to perform what are inherently governmental functions. And that includes carrying a weapon on U.S. battlefields. And that's certainly not where President Obama is right now.
But many people will say, of course, the truth, which is he inherited a quagmire from the Bush administration. What's he to do?
Well, there's no question that Obama inherited an absolute mess from President Bush. But the reality is that Obama is escalating the war in Afghanistan right now and is maintaining the occupation of Iraq. If Obama was serious about fully ending the occupation of Iraq, he wouldn't allow the U.S. to have a colonial fortress that they're passing off as an embassy in Baghdad. Bill, this place is the size of 80 football fields. Who do you think is going to run the security operation for this 80 football field size embassy? Well, it's mercenary contractors.
So we're supposed to be withdrawing from Iraq, but you're suggesting in all that you've written that I've read lately that we will be leaving a large mercenary force there.
Absolutely. In fact, you're going to have a sizable presence, not only of U.S. forces, certainly in the region, but also in Iraq, these residual forces. I mean, Bill, you remember during Vietnam, the people who were classified as military advisors or analysts, and in reality, the U.S. was fighting an undeclared war. So in Iraq, I think that we've seen reports reports from Jim Mikleshevsky, NBC News' Pentagon correspondent. He's quoting military sources saying that they expect to be in Iraq 15 to 20 years in sizable numbers. Afghanistan, though, really is going to become Obama's war, and unfortunately, many Democrats are portraying it as the good war.
Let me show you a snippet of what he said in Cairo on Thursday. Take a look.
Now make no mistake, we do not want to keep our troops in Afghanistan. We see no military, we seek no military bases there. It is agonizing for America to lose our young men and women. It is costly and politically difficult to continue this conflict. We would gladly bring every single one of our troops home if we could be confident that there were not violent extremists in Afghanistan and now Pakistan determined to kill as many Americans as they possibly can. But that is not yet the case.
Well, I mean, we have two parallel realities here. We have the speeches of President Obama. I'm not questioning his sincerity. And then you have the sort of official punditry that's allowed access to the corporate media. And they have one debate. On the ground, though, in Afghanistan and Pakistan, you hear the stories of the people that are forced to live on the other side of the barrel of the gun that is U.S. foreign policy, and you get a very different sense. If the United States, as President Obama says, doesn't want a permanent presence in Afghanistan, why allocate $1 billion to build this fortress-like embassy, similar to the one in Baghdad, in Islamabad, Pakistan, another one in Peshawar, having an increase in mercenary forces, expanding the U.S. military presence there?
Walter Pincus is an old friend of mine, an investigative reporter at the Washington Post for, you know, 30 or more years now, a very respected man. He reported in the Washington Post last fall that these contracts indicate how long the United States intends to remain in Afghanistan. And he pointed, for example, to a contract given by the Corps of Engineers to a firm in Dubai to build, to expand the prison, the U.S. prison at Bagram in Afghanistan. What does that say to you?
Look, we have President Obama making it a point regularly to say we're going to have Guantanamo closed by early next year. The fact is that at Bagram, we see an expansion. They're spending $60 million to expand that prison. You have hundreds of people held without charges. You have people that are being denied access to the Red Cross in violation of international law. And you have an ongoing position by the Obama administration, formed under Bush, that these prisoners don't have right to habeas corpus. There are very disturbing signals being sent with Afghanistan as a microcosm, not to mention these regular attacks that we're seeing inside of Pakistan that have killed upwards of 700 civilians using these robotic drones since 2006, including 100 since Obama took power.
Some people have suggested that the increasing reliance on military contractors in Afghanistan underscores the fact that the military is actually stretched very thin. General McChrystal said this week, he admitted that he doesn't even know if we have enough troops there to deal with the situation as it is now. Does that surprise you?
No, it doesn't surprise me because this is increasingly turning into a war of occupation. That's why General McChrystal is making that statement. If this was about fighting terrorism, it would be viewed as a law enforcement operation where you're going to hunt down criminals responsible for these actions and bring them in front of a court of law. This is turning into a war of occupation. And if I might add about General McChrystal, what message does it send to the Afghan people when President Obama chooses a man who is alleged to have been one of the key figures running secret detention facilities in Iraq and working on these extrajudicial killing squads, hunting down quote-unquote insurgents and killing them on behalf of the U.S. military? This is a man who's also alleged to have been at the center of the cover-up of Pat Tillman's death, who was killed by U.S. Army Rangers.
That sends a devastating... He apologized for that this week, by the way, before Congress.
Well, it's easy to apologize when your new job is on the line. It's a different thing to take responsibility for it when you realize that the mistake was made or that you were involved with what the family of Pat Tillman says was a cover-up.
You know, you talk about military contracts. Do you think the American people have any idea how their tax dollars are being used in Afghanistan?
Right. Absolutely no idea whatsoever. We've spent $190 billion on the war in Afghanistan, and some estimates say that within a few short years it could end up at $500 billion. The fact is that I think most Americans are not aware that their dollars being spent in Afghanistan are in fact going to for-profit corporations in both Iraq and Afghanistan. These are companies that are simultaneously working for profit and for the U.S. government. That is the intricate linking of corporate profits to an escalation of war that President Eisenhower warned against in his farewell address. We live amidst the most radical privatization agenda in the history of our country, and it cuts across every aspect of our society.
You recently wrote about how the Department of Defense paid the former Halliburton subsidiary KBR more than $80 million in bonuses for contracts to install what proved to be very defective electrical wiring in Iraq. Senator Byron Dorgan himself called that wiring in hearings shoddy and unprofessional. So my question is, why did the Pentagon pay for it when it was so inferior?
This is perhaps one of the greatest corporate scandals of the past decade. The fact that this Halliburton Corporation, which was once headed by former Vice President Dick Cheney, was essentially given keys to the city of U.S. foreign policy and allowed to do things that were dangerous for U.S. troops, provide them with unclean drinking water. They were the premier company responsible for servicing the U.S. military occupation of Iraq. In fact, they were deployed alongside the U.S. military in the buildup to the war. This was a politically connected company that won its contracts because of its political connections. And the fact is that it was a behemoth that was there. It was the girl at the dance. And they danced with her.
Yeah, the Army hired a master electrician, I read in some congressional testimony, to review electrical work in Iraq. He's now told Congress that KBR's work in Iraq was, quote, the most hazardous, worst quality work he'd ever seen, and that his own investigation, this is not a journalist, an employee of the Army, had found improper wiring in every building that KBR had
And we're talking about thousands of buildings. And so we've had U.S. troops that have died from electrocution in Iraq as a result of the faulty work of KBR. This should be an utter scandal that should outrage every single person in this country. And yet you find almost no mention of this in the corporate media.
Do you get discouraged writing about corruption that never gets cured?
Well, I don't believe that it necessarily doesn't get cured. I think that I'm very heartened by the fact that we have a very vibrant independent media landscape that's developing right now. You know, to me, I once put on the tagline of an article that I wrote early on in the Obama administration that I pledged to be the same journalist under Barack Obama that I was under President Bush. And the reason I felt that it was necessary to say that is that I feel like we have a sort of blue state Fox culture in the media where people are willing to go above and beyond the call of partisan politics to give Obama the benefit of the doubt. This is a man. It's time to take off the Obama t-shirts. This is a man who's in charge of the most powerful country on earth. The media in this country, we have an obligation to treat him the way we treated Bush in terms of being critical of him. And yet I feel like many Democrats have had their spine surgically removed these days, as have a lot of journalists. The fact is that this man is governing over a policy that is killing a tremendous number of civilians.
You mentioned drones a moment ago. I was impressed to hear the new commander of our troops in Afghanistan admit this week that the United States cannot go on killing civilians. He said, in fact, this is creating a dangerous situation for our own country.
Well, on the one hand, that those words are true. I think that the fact is that when you are killing civilians in what is perceived to be an indiscriminate way, certainly by the people of Pakistan, you're going to give rise to more people that want to attack the United States. They view themselves as fighting a defensive war. But never are the statistics cited that come out of Pakistan. 687 people are documented to have been killed that the Pakistani authorities say are civilians since 2006. In the first 99 days of this year, over 100 people were killed. And the fact
is, by American military action?
Right, by American military action with these robotic drones.
60 Minutes on CBS News recently got some very special access to the military and came out with a report on drones. Let me show you a few excerpts from that.
Right now, there are dozens of them in the skies over Iraq and Afghanistan, hunting down insurgents every minute of every day. The fight for the pilots is on a video screen. Here, a truck full of insurgents in Afghanistan is being tracked by the pilot. When the ground commander gives the order, he fires, hitting his target. The trigger is pulled in Nevada, inside these cramped single-wide trailers and small offices.
And that white spot that this guy is carrying is actually a hot gun. It's been fired, and we already know that it's been used. We've met positive identification criteria that these are bad guys. And so now we can go ahead and strike these targets.
Now, many people are like that fella. They say that these drones are new miracle weapons that enable the United States military to kill the bad guys, as he said, without exposing Americans to danger. There's truth in that, right?
Now, I have a lot of respect for Laura Logan, the CBS correspondent. She's really put her neck on the line and been in the thick of battle and has been injured in battle. But I think that this piece was propaganda. She allowed the military to make claims about the effectiveness of their weapons that are being contested passionately by the people on the ground in Pakistan itself. I recently did an article about Time Magazine's coverage of this. They said that the Taliban are using civilians as human shields, and that's why so many civilians have been killed. Their source for that was an Air Force intelligence officer who was allowed to speak on as though it was a Pentagon press release. I think that this is sick, where you turn war essentially into a video game that can be waged by people half a world away. What this does, these drones, is it sanitizes war. It means that we increase the number of people that don't have to see that war is hell on the ground. And it means that wars are going to be easier in the future because it's not as tough of a sell.
You will find agreement on people who say war is hell, but you'll also find a lot of people in this country, America, a lot of Democrats and Republicans who say Jeremy Scahill is wrong, that we need to be doing what we're doing in Afghanistan, because if we don't, there'll be another attack like 9/11 on this country.
I think that what we're doing in Afghanistan increases the likelihood that there's going to be another attack, because we're killing innocent civilians regularly. When the United States goes in and bombs Farah province in Afghanistan on May 4th and kills civilians, according to the Red Cross and other sources, 13 members of one family, that is a ricochet impact. The relatives of those people are going to say, maybe they did trust the United States. Maybe they viewed the United States as a beacon of freedom in the world. But you just took that guy's daughter. You just killed that guy's wife. That's one more person that's going to line up and say, we're going to fight the United States. We are indiscriminately killing civilians, according to the UN Human Rights Council. A report that was just released this week by the UN says that the United States is indiscriminately killing civilians in Afghanistan and elsewhere around the world. That should be a collective shame that we feel in this society, and yet we have people calling it the good war.
So step back to the issue of military contractors. You've been writing about privatization of military contractors for a long time. In the large scheme of things, what do military contractors represent to you?
Well, I think that what we have seen happen as a result of this incredible reliance on private military contractors is that the United States has created a new system for waging war, where you no longer have to depend exclusively on your own citizens to sign up for the military and say, I believe in this war, so I'm willing to sign up and risk my life for it. You turn the entire world into your recruiting ground. You intricately link corporate profits to an escalation of warfare and make it profitable for companies to participate in your wars. In the process of doing that, you undermine U.S. democratic processes, and you also violate the sovereignty of other nations because you're making their citizens combatants in a war to which their country is not a party. I feel that the end game of all of this could well be the disintegration of the nation state apparatus in the world, and it could be replaced by a scenario where you have corporations with their own private armies. To me, that would be a devastating development, but it's happening on a micro level, and I fear it will start to happen on a much bigger scale.
Jeremy Scahill, thanks for being with me again on The Journal.
It's been an honor, Bill.